All right, let's talk about the movable portion of the skull, or the mandible. A lot of times we refer to this as the lower jaw. And really, this is the most robust in terms of the bones of your skull because you have a lot of muscle attachment here, particularly those really strong muscles of mastication. So they all have to attach the mandible in some way. So we're looking at an anterior view here. You're going to have the body of the mandible. You're going to have the ramus of the mandible. That's the part that projects up towards the skull. And then you're going to have the internal portion, which we'll look at in just a moment. So probably the most prominent thing that you see here is that obviously this is where your mandibular teeth sit. And this is a good time to talk about the differences in terms of the teeth. You have four types of teeth. You have your incisors, which are the more anteriorly placed. You'll have a central incisor and a lateral incisor. Next to that, you'll have your canine. You only have one canine per quadrant, so four in terms of the entirety of your mouth. So one canine, sometimes it's a little bit more pointed. With age, this will wear down typically. Now, in adult dentition, you'll have two premolars, and a lot of times you hear these referred to as bicuspids. They're called bicuspids because they have two cusps, two points in terms of the bone. Now, let's talk a little bit about the difference between adults and juvenile dentition. In juvenile dentition, you do not have any premolars. So premolars are unique to adult dentition. Now moving more posteriorly, you'll have three molars, your first molar, second molar, and third molar. And we often refer to the third molar as your wisdom teeth. So most people have had these removed. Some individuals never actually form wisdom teeth. So in this particular individual, they did have a third molar. Now in juveniles, you'll have two molars, but not a third molar. So that's why you have a differing amount of teeth in juveniles. All right, so let's talk about some of the structures that you want to know in terms of the mandible. When you're looking at the ramus, or this vertical portion, the more anterior projection is referred to as your coronoid process. This is going to be the distal attachment of your temporalis muscle. So this large muscle that sits on the side of your skull is going to attach on the temporalis right there. So one of the broadest muscles of the skull. The more posterior projection is your mandibular condyle. And this is what is articulating with the mandibular fossa of your temporal bone. And this is going to be the mandible portion of your TMJ joint, or your temporomandibular joint. Now, one other thing we want to look at this anterior view are these two foramina on either side. These are your mental foramen. I always think about putting your, really thinking hard, putting your hand right here, thinking, mental. This is where V3, or your sensory branch of your third division of your trigeminal nerve, is going to exit. So important in terms of providing sensory innervation in this region. Okay, now we're going to look inside in terms of the mandible. And there's a lot of important areas right here, particularly in terms of clinical practice for dentists. So let's start with probably the most important region. This is what's referred to as your mandibular foramen. You can see that it's kind of entering a canal right here. Your inferior alveolar nerve is going to enter the bone in this region. Your inferior alveolar nerve is providing sensory innervation to all of these mandibular teeth. So if you think about a dentist that needs to anesthetize this region, they're going to try to put the anesthetic right around this region, and it'll knock out all that quadrant of the teeth right here. So inferior alveolar nerve, or the third division of trigeminal nerve. Now, how are you going to find that? Well, obviously, they're very well trained, but one thing they're going to do is they're going to enter their finger right around this region and feel what's referred to as the lingula. So your lingula is this little projection of bone right here. So they'll feel that, they'll palpate that, they'll put the anesthetic right in here. So knock out half of these teeth if you're doing it here, and if you were to put it in this region, knock out this half of the teeth. All right, also importantly, you see right here there's a buildup of bone. This is referred to as the mylohyoid line. So your mylohyoid muscle, which forms the floor of the mouth, is going to attach here. and you have two important glands right in this region. Inferiorly, you have your submandibular gland. Superiorly, you have your sublingual gland. These are two of your salivary glands that are going to be associated with this region.